Hello, everyone, and welcome back to the Cisco Optics Podcast, where we talk about pluggable optics for networks. After you plug the optic into the switch, router, or server, you're not done. You still have to plug in a fiber optic cable. What does this fiber cable infrastructure look like? It's a lot more sophisticated than you might imagine. This is episode 14, and we conclude a conversation with Brian Kelly of Panduit. I've worked with Brian for a number of years because Cisco and Panduit have basically the same customers, even though we don't make the same products. Cisco is a network gear provider, and Panduit is a fiber cable infrastructure provider. You need both, the hardware and the fiber cable, to complete your network. In this final part of our six-part conversation, we hear about some of the latest developments that Brian has been working on at Panduit. Brian L. Kelly joined Panduit in 2012. In 2014, he joined corporate R&D as a solution architect. Prior to joining Panduit, he worked for 14 years in the telecommunications and data center colocation industries. Currently, Brian manages Panduit's network architecture team, which develops reference architecture content for the data center and enterprise businesses. In addition, he manages the Panduit Labs network, which provides secure connectivity and resources to their labs in Tinley Park, Illinois. Brian has written well over 20 technical papers that have been published on the Panduit website as well as partner websites. Brian owns a bachelor's degree from Illinois State University and a master's degree in business administration from Keller Graduate School of Management. On top of all of that, he's a great guy. If you haven't already, please subscribe to this podcast. It may show up as a Cisco Podcast Network, which has other great podcast series as well. Check out our blog at blogs.cisco.com and search on hashtag Cisco Optics Blog, all one word, no hyphen, and no spaces. You'll find podcast notes and links there too. For our YouTube playlist, go to youtube.com and search on Cisco Optics. And for product information, go to cisco.com/go/optics. And now, join me as I talk with Brian Kelly. So what's been going on? What's the latest stuff that has you excited?
Yeah, so you know, we just came out with our new cabinets, the Flex Fusion cabinets. It's our third generation of cabinets that we've come out with. It's the third redesign that we've done on these, and these cabinets are just really cool. They have so many things built into them. There's so many attachment points within the cabinet itself to really utilize the space and optimize the space. You know, so we have a lot of attachment points for cage nuts, for you know, different types of modules. So, for instance, we have slots that where you can put in some of our QuickNet attachments.
Can you back up 1 second? What is a cage nut?
Oh yeah, so cage nuts. I don't know if you've ever seen a cabinet. They have square holes in the rails, and what you do is you put a little cage nut, and it's a nut for like a bolt that has a little cage around it, and you pop it into that cage, and that basically that cage actually kind of sits there like two fingers. If you were just doing it like without the cage, like, and you had somebody holding the nut right in the right spot so that when you push the screw through, it would be perfect. That's basically what the cage does.
Oh, okay. It's the hole in the rail. It's not a threaded hole. You have to put its nut behind it in order to have something for the screw to thread into.
Yeah. So originally, a lot of racks and cabinets had threaded holes in them, but when people go too crazy with the screw gun and tear the threads out of that, it's kind of done.
Okay.
So they had to kind of redesign. This is, you know, 20 years, 25 years ago that this kind of happened, because people would torque it too much and they would break the threads. So you got to sit there with a threader and use a slightly larger. Well, that doesn't play very well, you know, long run. So they made these cages that went around the nuts, and you can pop them out and, you know, replace them if you have to. Sometimes, you know, you may just get misaligned just a little bit and tear some of the threads out. Just pull the cage nut out and then put in a new cage nut, and then you're good to go.
Okay.
So we built a lot of those holes that you generally see into in the rails themselves into different parts of the cabinet so that you could attach whatever you might want to attach at some point with a, you know, with a cage nut, with a screw that will go into that. But we also, the holes in the cabinet that we have specifically built for like our QuickNet fiber modules, where it just clicks right in, and you can do patching instead of doing the patch panel in RU in the cabinet itself with the patch panel. You can do it on the side of the air dams where we actually have these holes. You could just plug the cassette into that and connect right to the side of the cabinet while saving sometimes 2 or 3 RU of patch panels that might be in that cabinet.
Wait, so the where is the air dam?
That's hard without the visual.
Yeah. But is it actually the side face of the cabinet, or is it off to the side but still the front face of the cabinet or the back face?
Both, actually.
Okay, so basically, is it outside the rails?
Yeah, it's basically the outside part of the rails.
Oh, okay.
Front
area. It's just more area on the face that you can utilize.
But previously, those faces were unused. Like there was nothing there, so it was like kind of wasted space. And we're like, let's put these holes in here, and you can do a multitude of different things. And if you're not doing anything, there's just a little cover that goes over it, and it works great. You know, it's really cool. And then we have like several pass-throughs. Yeah, absolutely. I mean, you can have more density now in your actual RUs in the cabinet and have the patching on the outside now instead of having to consume RU with your patch panels.
Yeah. Cool.
And then there's all kinds of pass-throughs that were built into it. So there's a special kind of flip-up pass-through at the back side of the cabinet that you can pass like a huge amount of cables through. And that's something people don't think about. Like, how do you get your cables in from your trays into the cabinet without affecting the thermal, usability of your cabinet? It's like, drill a hole? No, like there should be something there. So, in our second cabinet, we had these pop-out things, and we still have those in the new Flex Fusion cabinet. But we also have a couple different designs with brush, where you can just actually pass it through these brushes, and the one big flip-up one that we have that really provides a lot of value.
So these brushes are literally like brush bristles?
Yeah, they're like brush bristles, and you just put the cable through and it goes right through it, but it provides enough separation that it won't affect the cabinet thermally.
Okay, so it's like a hole in the metal, but the brushes prevent the air from coming out the hole?
Yeah, they prevent the air from coming down or up, but the cables pass right through. So it's really cool. It's really,
that is
really
cool.
Innovative design.
And this is generally the top of the rack?
Yeah, the top of the rack. I believe there are some. No, I guess they're all on the top. I was thinking there might be. No, there was nothing on the side. The sides actually have panels. I mean, the panels are actually removable based on whether you want them to be separated, or if you have, like, say, 10 of them ganged together, you can actually pass cables through the inside of the cabinet. But the sides just have the side panels on them.
Cool. So this is all, these are all new features in this, the Flex Fusion.
Yeah. Cabinet. Yeah, most of those are first time that we've done them in the Flex Fusion cabinet. But it's a really cool design, and it just launched, I think, in April.
Oh, okay.
So it's fairly new.
Very nice.
But the other one I kind of mentioned it earlier that my team has been working on is the Rapid ID. And this is something that when we first started showing this to people, they're like, it's so simple. We don't already do this. And we were like, no, we don't. So what we did is, starting back in March, I believe it was, every fiber patch cord, every copper patch cord that we sell has three labels on it now. Two of them are what we call rapid ID labels, which are unique labels that are on each end of the cable. Mm-hmm. And then we have the QC, the quality control label that we've always had on our cables.
Okay, so on that, one that'll have like a serial number or something.
Yeah, it has like it has information about the manufacturer, where it was manufactured, like what time of day it was manufactured, and then like you can actually pull some data from that, especially on fiber. Like you can pull the insertion loss numbers for that fiber if you scan that QC, which is something that we already had. So what we did is we put the rapid ID labels on each end of the connection. And basically what you do is you install it and then you scan it with the location that it's in. So like say for instance, your one side is in a switch, one side's in a patch panel. On one side, you're going to say switch one, port one, and then you scan each cable as you go along. And every time it scans, it moves to port two. So you scan one, two. Actually, there's nothing in port three. You have a little feature that skips one, and now you're going four, five, six, seven, eight. You put it into an app, and then you go to the other side. And you say, okay, this is now patch panel one, and you're going to scan port one, one, two, three, four, or one, two, three. Oh, we skip one, four, five, six, and so on. And what the software does is it says, okay, well, the cable that is in port one is actually in the port two on the patch panel. And so it aligns, it correlates those scans so that you know the A end is here and the Z end is here. And where it really comes into play is on the trunks. So on those long runs that may be 100 meters, when you scan the backs of those and then you scan the backs in the other patch panel, now you know exactly where those cables run.
Okay. So,
because before, what you would have to do is, you'd have to actually go follow the cable. You know, like a lot of times they're like in a bundle. So you got to unbundle them to follow the cable up. Yeah. What a nightmare.
I think it's so funny. Yeah. I've seen like those red light tools where they say, well, just plug the red light into one end of the fiber and then go to the other end of the trunk and look for the red light coming out.
Yeah, and there are a lot of tools like that, a lot of legacy tools that you do with that. But the problem is with those tools is you have to disconnect to do that.
And then
this allows you to do it without ever.
And what if that tool is, dirty? If the last guy that used it.
Yeah, true.
Again.
What if somebody just ate a bunch of barbecue? Yeah. No, that's absolutely, that's a great point on this because the beauty of rapid ID is that you don't have to disconnect anything. You can do this while the fiber is still connected or the copper is still connected. You don't have to disconnect them.
You can just do it later.
It can still be running traffic and you just scan it and find it. And then, so we have a scan mode, which is basically what I just talked about there. And then we have a find mode too. So you may scan like this. We believe this cable is bad on port three. So you scan that cable and we know it goes over here, but I want to make sure I'm getting the right cable. And it actually has an audio, it'll be like ah, 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 ding, when you get to the right cable. So it'll like, you'll scan and it'll be like, no, that's not the cable. Nope, that's not the cable. Nope, that's not the cable.
Oh, so you're just kind of running. Do you use your phone for this?
You can. It doesn't work as well because the scanners on the phone are not quite as precise.
Oh, okay.
So you got to think about the density.
You have a dedicated.
We have a dedicated scanning tool. Okay. Yeah.
So you just run.
It's actually got.
You're just running along all these QR, these barcodes, and then and then it's making the noise, and it alerts you when you hit the right one.
Yeah. So like you're looking for this cable, and you just the scanner is kind of a really cool design too. It's got a little like hook, so that you're making sure that you're scanning the right cable. So this hook is right at the right length to scan perfectly with the gun. And, you know, you put it on each cable and it's like, okay, that's not it. It's like, ding. And you're like, okay, it's this cable right here that we need to remove. So it kind of takes out a lot of the guesswork that you would have in the, you know, the previous iteration of cable. So it's such a simple thing. I mean, we really just put labels on cables, but the value of that is really great. I mean, it's amazing. Yeah, we showed it to several people and they're like, wait, I thought we were already doing this. We're like, no, nobody's doing this. Like,
and it's the difference between sending somebody out for hours or for 3 minutes, right?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it cuts down the troubleshooting time drastically, just because you know you have these different modes that you can use to, you know, one, catalog everything and have it in software so that you really know, you know, where all these cables are at. And then two, confirm that, yeah, that is the thing, to make sure that you're pulling the right cable. And then the third option is what we call audit mode, which is it's basically confirming that what we thought was there is what's there. So like you could do this on a annual basis or whatever basis that you wanted to do it on time wise and just scan. And it's like ding, 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 ding. And it's like, oh, I thought this cable was going to be there and this cable is what showed up. And it'll make an audible like, you know, notification that like that's not what I thought was going to be there.
And from your perspective,
because sometimes people move stuff in the middle of the night or whatever, you know, and like don't catalog it correctly.
Not telling anyone.
Yeah, don't tell anybody. You know, they'll never notice.
Maybe on April 1st or something. I don't know.
Yeah, that too.
From your view, from where you stand, how important do you think it is for, you know, the people actually running the networks, like the operations people, how important is it that things like this are just more efficient or take less time?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. I mean, that's a huge piece. If anybody's ever troubleshot a connection that was down in the middle of the night and, you know, your website's down because of it and you're not able to take orders and you're trying to find a cable, the pressure, this is from personal experience, like the pressure that you feel is just immense. I mean, and having a tool like that that could help you quickly diagnose the issue that you're having and get back up is invaluable. I mean, it's just...
And do people recognize the value, like with their wallets, I guess? Like, is it, cause it's kind of like, I don't know, it might be like insurance to some extent, right?
Yeah. I mean,
you might not want to pay for it until you actually need it, which is kind of too late.
The funny part is, so one of the things that, both myself and Kevin Marley, the guy that works for me that's the inventor on this, really went to the business with is like, we can't charge more for this. And they're like, what? No, we have to charge more for this. And we're like, no, you can't charge more for this. Like, and you have to do it on all the cables. No, we only want to do it on certain. No, it doesn't have any value if you don't put it on all the cables. And then if you charge more for it, like it's going to really affect. You're going to make up so much more by selling them at the same price. You're going to have so much more volume. And eventually, it took a while, but they did see the light on it. And customers are like, wait, this isn't going to cost me millions of dollars more? No. I mean, it's something that's going to be on our standard price. I mean, that's it's not awesome. Like we raised the price a ton. So yeah, that's a huge value. And it's like, you get all this value and you don't have to pay anything for it. Like, the only thing that the scanner is going to be, a nominal fee. It's not going to be a huge expense, but, and the app is going to be free and everything too. So it's really an amazing tool. And, I'm glad that we stuck to our guns on a lot of this stuff, and it's going to bring so much value to the customer.
And I think you mentioned at least one customer said, "You mean it's not already yeah. there?"
Well, that was actually an internal person. We don't do that already. It's so simple. Like, why are we not doing that? I'm like, I don't know, but we're not, and nobody else is either. So. It's really cool. It's funny. I was talking to a group of my colleagues and about innovation, and I was like, innovation does not have to be the most difficult thing in the world. Like sometimes it's the most simple things that you just don't think about. And the guy that works for me, Ken, yeah, simple is perfect. Like, this was Kevin, who was the inventor on this. Kevin Marley is his name. He actually worked in our IT department for years, and he dealt with this on a daily basis. And when he came in and started working for me, and his job kind of changed from an IT person to an IT person that's trying to innovate. He was like, "This is such a problem in the data center. Like, when I send a guy out to a data center at 2 o'clock in the morning and he's going through the cables, like, it's insane." And I'm like, I actually was like, "Oh yeah, I remember those days from when I worked in colocation." And it's so simple, but like, it's so valuable. And like, it doesn't have to be like some crazy invention that. It doesn't have to be the iPhone. It can be something that is so simple and like, but really brings so much value. So,
and it makes sense that you had, so I guess in his previous role in IT, he was basically a model for the end customer.
Yeah. We call it voice of customer. We're always like, did you get voice of customer or VOC on this? Which is like, did you show the customer and like, see what they're like? Kevin was the voice of customer. Like, he had to deal with it on a daily basis. And, yeah. He was like, "Man, if we could do something around this, like," and, so I'm like, "Hey, start thinking about that." And this is what we came up with. And like I said, I mean, so simple, but really innovative.
That's great. I mean, that sounds like a really good, just an operational model. Cause you get that.
Yeah, absolutely. Our business unit was not too. Can you imagine if you pitched a new transceiver that would be exactly the same cost? And
well,
what? No, we can't do that.
If I said we had to give it away for free, yeah, I don't know how that would fly.
Yeah.
Well, actually, I do know how it wouldn't.
Yeah, it would not go right. Yeah, it's it's basically that we're just not raising the cost on the new stuff.
All right. Anything else you want to bring up?
Yeah, I think that's about it.
Okay.
I think we've been talking for two hours.
The cabling guides. I'll put the link.
Yeah.
Because we have it both on Cisco.com and the webpage on Pandua.com that has the
absolutely
the collection of a variety of stuff, right?
Yeah, it's got a whole bunch of different content up there. A lot of the stuff that we've done and that our groups have done together. Really cool stuff.
Yeah.
Right. And then you guys have the Matrix too, right?
The Matrix. Yeah. We have our own set of online tools that keeps expanding. It started with the compatibility matrix. And now we have this compatibility matrix, which was the platform to optic compatibility matrix, and now we have the interoperability, which is optical interoperability between two different optics. I don't know if we told you we have another tool now that's basically like the data sheet, but it's the searchable, filterable GUI. just two matrices. So you don't have to look up, 14 different data sheet web static web pages. But the same information.
That's awesome. Yeah. That's really cool. Yeah. That's
really nice.
Super valuable.
Yeah. Thanks for mentioning that. So I'll put those links in the notes too.
Yeah.
Well, Brian, it's been a pleasure. Thanks so much for taking the time. I know we spent almost a couple hours here. And I can't wait to see you in person again.
Yeah, I know. Gosh, hopefully soon. Hopefully we'll get back to normal here soon and we can start traveling more regularly and get out and see you guys.
Yeah, that'd be great. Thanks again. Have a great day.
All right. All right, take care.
That was the sixth and final part of my conversation with Brian Kelly. I hope you enjoyed it as much as I did. Subscribe to this podcast, and we'd really appreciate you helping to get the word out. Share this with friends and colleagues that come to mind when you think of network technology and optics, and leave a review on Apple Podcast, formerly known as iTunes. We're also on all the other major podcast platforms. You may see the Cisco Podcast Network come up when you search for Cisco Optics Podcast. That's where we live, and you can find other great podcasts there too. Also, check out the Cisco Optics blogs at blogs.cisco.com and search on hashtag Cisco Optics Blog, no spaces and no hyphens. We also have educational videos on YouTube. Just go to youtube.com and search on Cisco Optics. Thank you for listening. This is Pat Chow, product manager at Cisco Optics. Next episode, we'll have a new guest and new topic. Until next time.